Great to see everyone and to have everyone with us for our kickoff for the season. I'm going to introduce our speaker, Professor David Yaffe, who is here visiting us from New York, where he is a professor of humanities at Syracuse University's College of Arts and Sciences. There, David teaches on 20th and 21st century American fiction, poetry, music, and creative nonfiction. He grew up and was born and grew up in Dallas, Texas, and received his BA from Sarah Lawrence College and his PhD in English from the CUNY Graduate Center in New York. He's the author of Fascinating Rhythm, Reading Jazz in American Writing, which was his first book. And his second book, which he spoke about last night, was Bob Dylan, Like a Complete Unknown. And his third recent book, which he'll be speaking about today, is Reckless Daughter, Portrait of Joni Mitchell. And in addition to his books, he's very well published on music, film, theater, dance, in a wide variety of popular mainstream publications, including Harper's, Slate, The New York Times, New York, The Village Voice, The New Republic, Book Forum. I'm sure there's many others. I just got a few of those were the first ones I pulled off the web. Remember that after our talk today, Professor Yaffe will be signing books outside. So enjoy the lecture and buy books. They're good for all of us. Thank you.
Thank you, Alana. Thank you, Cheryl. Thank you, everybody here. It's wonderful to be here. I had a wonderful experience yesterday. Everybody treated me with such kindness. When I was very young, I went to the Jewish Community Center preschool in Dallas between the ages of 3 and 6. And so some of my earliest memories are connected to the JCC. I still remember the names of all of my teachers from the JCC. And I'm amazed when I meet college students, they don't remember like who their political science professor was like the previous semester. But I do remember Mrs. Holtzman from when I was 3. She was very generous with me. Mrs. Brown, not so much, when I was 4. Because you know the left hand is the devil's hand, and so she made me write with my right hand, and so I developed a stammer for a little while because of that. And she preferred my older brother, so she had terrible taste. And then I remember my teachers in fifth grade. I remember the whole thing. My kindergarten year was a very big deal at the JCC. But not as big a deal as this right here. So thank you for being here. Here's a place where I can start with Joni Mitchell that most people don't know about. Joni, like in her 50s, she sort of became interested in her genealogy. Her maiden name is Anderson. Her maiden name is Roberta Joan Anderson. And her public name is Joni, so I always called her Joni. But men who had been intimate with her called her Joan. Okay? But Roberta Joan, she's born in 1943. But she was curious because she was told that her background was Scandinavian, and yet the spelling of her name wasn't Scandinavian. It wasn't Anderson with an E. It was Anderson with an O. And she thought that was a little bit strange. And so she looked into it, and it turned out that her her father's name that was changed, and it had been Amberson. See where I'm going with this? And so she said to her racist mother, how does it feel being married to a Jewish Indian? Because she did also discover that he had Laplander blood. So anyway, nobody knows about that. I think it's in the book, though. Now you know about it. It's a good place to start. Anyway, so I wanted to start with this song, which is a place where a lot of people start because this is Joni's most popular album, Blue. It's the album that the most people love, and whether they love it for the right reasons or not is something we can talk about. I think that they actually probably do love it for the right reasons. But anyway, I wanted to share this with you because this to me was the sound of discovering Joni Mitchell's music, which was also the sound of falling in love when I was 15. And so this is a song, maybe if you know anything about Joni, you probably know this song. It's called All I Want. It's the first song on Blue from 1971. Joni was in a very raw place when she was making this album. She was in such a raw place that she couldn't even look at strangers because she felt that she could see into people's souls and that she could see their darkness. So she couldn't go to the supermarket, you know, because everybody seemed to have the evil eye. She was going through something that we in the West would call a nervous breakdown, but she also thought of it possibly as a shamanistic awakening. And to understand Joni Mitchell is to understand both sides of that coin, if it's a coin. And so what you hear in the song is a lot of beauty and a lot of passion, but also a lot of ambiguity. And that's why this was really the sound of falling in love for me. Before I'd heard this record when I was 15, the only thing that I knew about Joni Mitchell was that she wrote Woodstock, which is something else we can talk about. But I didn't know her version of Woodstock, which is something else we can talk about because it's very different from the one that most people know by Crosby, Stills, and Nash. But here she is singing All I Want, and you've got the lyrics up here. And we'll talk about why this is the sound, at least for me, of falling in love, and also falling in love with Joni Mitchell's music. Yeah, we'll do full screen. How do we do full screen? Davey's got that. Thank you, Davey. Anyway, I'm going to stop this for 1 second. Ah! Can we go back to the screen? I just wanted to stop it for 1 second because what you're hearing, and this is sort of why this is falling in love, because if this was falling in love in like the simple way, then it would be this. Falling in love, and then maybe go to a relative minor chord. Falling in love, maybe do an A. Falling in love, baby, I love you so much. Falling in love, not interesting at all. Okay, Joni starts the song with a stacked chord. Before you get to that major chord, you get this. See? This is a form of chromatic harmony. You might have heard this term chromatic harmony. It comes from the Greek word chromos, chromatic. That means an interesting color is in there. So this makes you feel, you know, here's major, here's minor. People in the West, they tend to like their happiness major and their sadness minor. Very simple. Joni's like, no, that's not me. I'm wandering around happy sad. So what does it mean to wander around happy sad? It means this, right? And then it gets resolved. And this is like Joni's favorite thing to play on the piano is this. And then she resolves it. So even for people that don't know anything about music, they still feel it. And a lot of people have synesthesia. Joni has very acute synesthesia. And so you can hear different colors when you go from a... The marking for this kind of chord is S-U-S. Does anybody know what that stands for? Suspended, right? That's right, I've got some musicians in here. This is a suspended chord. So it's like you're suspended emotionally. And then you go to then you get your major chord. But it's not easy. Getting to happiness is not easy. And so that's the immediate message that you get. The first time I lied down with a high school girlfriend, she's a singer, she's a couple years older than me, and therefore way more sophisticated, because I'm 15 and she's 17, and there's a huge you know, between 45 and 47, you don't notice it. But between 15 and 17, you do notice it. So, right. So I'm 15, she's 17, you know, and I just defer to her and everything. And there's like an adult sophistication to the song. There's an adult eros, someone who's been through many love affairs already. To me, I'm still 15, wow, you know. And this like jaded 17-year-old is sharing this with me. Okay, so that's the experience of the chord. And then there's the way that her voice sounds, and then there are the words that she sings. And she says, I'm on a lonely road, and I'm traveling, 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 looking for something. What can it be? And now here I am, being the willing victim. The next verse is me being a sucker, right? I hate you some, I hate you some, I love you some. And I'm like, I'll take it. You give me two hates and then one love in the end, I'm going to stick around for all the hate because there's going to be a reward at the end. So, you know, but, you know, because I think this is it. This is falling in love, and this is you have to put up with this. And then she keeps going, I want to be strong. I want to laugh along. I want to belong to the living, alive, alive. I want to get up and jive. And now this, again, here's another reward. Ready? I want to wreck my stockings in some jukebox dive. That's another reward. You stick around for all that hatred, and you get into the stormy, tempestuous romance. And then, do you want to dance with me, baby? Of course. Do you want to take a chance on maybe finding some sweet romance with me, baby? Well, come on. Thank God. This is happening. This is happening. Okay. All I really, really want our love to do. Oh, we've got a love together now. Fantastic. Is to bring out the best in me and in you. How sweet. All I really want to do is to bring out the best. I want to talk to you. I want to shampoo you. I want to renew you again and again. Applause, applause. Life is our cause. When I think of your kisses, my mind seesaws. This is fantastic. But wait a minute. She's not done with me yet. Do you see? Do you see? Do you see how you hurt me, baby? So I hurt you too. Then we both get so blue. Oh, that's 15. And you come back for more. I'm on a lonely road and I am traveling, looking for the key to set me free. Oh, the jealousy, the greed is the unraveling. It's the unraveling, and it undoes all the joy that could be. I want to have fun. I want to shine like the sun. I want to be the one that you want to see. I want to knit you a sweater. I want to write you a love letter. I want to make you feel better. I want to make you feel free. I want to make you feel free. And so all of this is basically this, right? You have some moments of this, but then you got to go back to this. You're suspended. You're suspended emotionally. You're suspended. But it's also very, very beautiful. So I'm going to get, can we get back to the track, Davey? Thank you. And here's how it sounds. Now, by the way, I would say another word about the way this sounds. This was recorded for the Blue Album, which was her fourth studio album, came out in 1970 on Warner Reprise. The instrumentation on this album is very minimal. You got a little slide guitar by Sneaky Pete. You've got a little acoustic guitar by James Taylor, who was her boyfriend at the time. They were really making each other quite blue at that time. He was numbing from heroin to methadone, and she was coming to terms with this very shaky period in her life, which produced some of her most beautiful music. And but there was a percussion player, a studio musician that you might have heard of, named Russ Kunkel. Russ Kunkel also played drums on Carole King's Tapestry album. And in fact, Carole King was recording Tapestry in the same studio when Joni was recording Blue at the same time. They were fighting over the same piano. The Carpenters, this was an A&M studio in Los Angeles, which if you're ever in Los Angeles, it looks kind of the same as it looked then, except that now it's called Henson Studios, because that was Jim Henson Studios. And it had been Charlie Chaplin Studios. And so when Joni was recording there was a big sculpture of Charlie Chaplin. But when it became Jim Henson Studios, they went on that sculpture and they put Kermit the Frog's face on the sculpture. Anyway, so all this was going on in 1970, Studio A. So the Carpenters were A, Carol King was B, Joni was C, and it was like kind of all one big studio. James Taylor played on Tapestry and on Blue. Russ Kunkel played on Tapestry and on Blue. Joni told me that Carol King went up to her, and because they were listening to each other record sometimes, and Carol King went up to her and she said, "You don't like yourself. I can tell. I like myself." So it was like that. Okay. But Russ Kunkel. So when you hear this, you hear like a kind of like a subtle conga part. Kind of sounds like that. Okay. So Russ Kunkel was married to someone named Leah Kunkel. And Leah was friends with Mama Cass. And they all lived in the same neighborhood, which was Laurel Canyon in Los Angeles. And so Joni comes over with a guitar, sits on Russ Kunkel's bed, and starts singing these blue songs right at him. And he picks up a conga, it's kind of a detuned conga, and starts to thump on it a little bit. He realized that he was being auditioned. Can you imagine? You're on your bed. Joni Mitchell is sitting on the other side of your bed with her guitar, and she's singing these incredibly intimate and beautiful songs right at you, and she's expecting you to step up. Okay, so this is what that sounded like. It looks like she's disappearing into blue. Maybe in ecstasy, maybe in misery, maybe both.
I am on the road and I am traveling, looking for something, what can it be? Oh, I hate you some, I love you some. Oh, I love you when I forget about me. Strong, I wanna live alone, I wanna belong to the living, alive, I wanna get up and drive, wanna wreck my stockings in some jukebox top. Do you wanna dance with me, baby? Do you wanna take a chance on maybe finding some sweet romance with me, baby? Well, come on.
One of them is James Taylor, and one of them is Joni. Now, James Taylor is playing in standard tuning. Any guitar players in here? Anybody explain the difference between standard tuning and alternate tuning?
There's several alternate tunings.
But the idea of alternate tuning, I mean. Just the idea of it.
It just completely changes the sound of the instrument.
That's right. It changes the sound. It changes. That's right. So standard tuning, you just tune up to these notes. Right. It's a standard tuning, and then you have this normal E chord or whatever it is.
I don't know about her guitar. Does she play five string or does she play six string guitar?
She plays six string, but she always played alternate tunings. The reason that she played alternate tunings was because she had polio when she was 10. She was a polio survivor. And so when she tried to learn guitar out of the Pete Seeger book, there was something in there called cotton picking. Pete Seeger's family had a black maid named Elizabeth Cotton that showed him this thing. It was called cotton picking, and the base of it was just like this 1-5. 1-5, 1-5. She couldn't do that with her left hand. Her left hand was so weak that she couldn't do that. So what she did instead was that she discovered this with these alternate tunings that they're a pain in the butt because you've got to retune your guitar every few songs. And so when she was a folky, she would always have an anecdote to tell that would be exactly 3 minutes while she tuned her guitar to keep everybody interested. And she would also wear like mini skirts and things, and so people would have something nice to look at while they would also had a very charming story to hear while she was tuning her guitar. Now, there is something very interesting that comes out of the alternate tunings. The fact that they're difficult to play is ancillary to the more important thing about alternate tunings, is that they have far more resonance. If anybody here is a guitar player, then you know this. Alternate tunings have far more resonance than standard tunings. And what that means is that you can hear more in the overtones. The notes that are implied by the notes that are performed, you hear overtones, right? And it's like having a chord upon a chord upon a chord upon a chord. And so even if for people that don't know anything about music, they can still hear the difference, or they're somehow aware that they're hearing something different, even if they can't articulate what it is. So that's one of the extraordinary things about Joni as a musician. And it was a great thing that she brought to pop music, because she had about 80 different alternate tunings. And in fact, she would compose music often just by finding a tuning. A very unusual way of working. But the result is something that's deeper and more resonant than anything else. And so she also has more depth and resonance in her lyrics, and she also has more depth and resonance in the way that she sings. And she also had more complications in the way that she lived. And so all of this comes together for what creates a genius and what creates somebody who is truly contributing something original. Joni was obsessed with originality. She believed in astrology. She was born on the same day as Madame Curie. And she was born on the day of the discoverer, and she believed it. And it's also what made her so cranky and so tough on people, because she wanted everybody else to be a great original. And so it made her very disappointed in Bob Dylan at some points when he wasn't being as original as she thought he was. Anyway, I think we heard enough of that track to get the idea of it, though. And most of you probably know it anyway. But I wanted to get to this song because I wanted to at least summarize a little bit of what led up to Joni doing All I Want and making Blue, which was the album that she became the most well-loved for. What led up to that, and how did that happen? This is a song that, it's very poetic the way this all worked out. Joni, after 10 years of having no new material, released her final album of new material in 2007. The album was called Shine, had a guest appearance by James Taylor doing the thing he did on Blue, had a guest appearance by Herbie Hancock, and it was called Shine. So that same year that she went, just shortly after she finished recording it, which was when I met her. I met her when she was finishing recording Shine. Which I can tell you more about that. But Herbie Hancock was doing an album that was produced by Joni's ex-husband, Larry Klein. Herbie Hancock was doing an album of Joni's music called River, the Joni Letters. The album ended up winning the Album of the Year Grammy. It was because every other major Grammy that year was won by Amy Winehouse. Amy Winehouse was nominated for 5 Grammys. She won 4 of them, and this was the one she didn't win. It was the second time that a jazz album won a Grammy for Album of the Year. just the second time. The first one was Stan Getz. So this was a huge deal. But it was fascinating because Joni's mother had just passed away at the age of 95. And Larry thought it would be a good idea to have a tribute to her mother. So Joni had done this song about her parents meeting for an album in 1988 called Chalkmark in a Rainstorm. She redid the song for this album. And so you hear Joni at the end of her life, but what she's actually singing about is her conception. I mean, I don't know of anybody that wrote a song about her parents, about their parents having sex. But not only does she do it, but she does it so warmly. It's the way, she does it in such a beautiful way. And sometimes whenever people ask me, like, oh, what are your favorite Joni Mitchell songs? Or, like, what are Joni Mitchell's greatest songs? I get asked that all the time. And I just think of the songs that are, like, the most definitively Joni. The songs where I can hear the Joni who talked to me. I can hear the way she could turn a thought. And I could see her talking to me even. And this is a song like that. As I mean, most people don't know it, but this is a song like that. And in fact, when Joni's mother, Myrtle, she was 26. She was working at a bank in Regina. This was 1943, it was, or 42. It was, the war was on. And she was on a lunch break with a colleague, and they had their tea leaves read. And the woman that read their tea leaves said, oh, you'll be married in a month and you'll have your first child within a year. And then she said, that's crazy. The war is on, there are no men. You know, how's that gonna happen? And then just sure enough, Bill Anderson, he's in the Royal Expeditionary Navy. He's on 2 weeks shore leave. He meets Myrtle, and the prophecy is fulfilled. But Joni does a very funny thing in these lyrics. I'm sure it's meant to be funny. I hope it's meant to be funny, because I find it very funny. Which is, and then this was the pseudonym she used, Molly McGee. Her mother's name was actually Molly McKee. When she re-recorded this for Herbie, she said she used her real name, Molly McKee. Okay, so she says, newsreels rattled the Nazi dread, the able-bodied have shipped away. Molly McKee gets her tea leaves read. You'll be married in a month, they say. And then this to me is a punchline. These leaves are crazy. Right? I think that's funny because she's not saying that's crazy. She's actually as if the leaves were people with ideas. Do you know what I mean? Like, oh, but these leaves are crazy. Whereas, like, most people would think that having your tea leaves read is kind of crazy. I think that's Joni's humor in there. These leaves are crazy. Look at this town. There's no men left. Just frail old boys and babies talking to teacher in the treble clef. And that's very Joni's language, putting it into the treble clef is here, right? These little high voices. I thought that was a really funny way of putting it. And then she plants her garden in the spring. She does the winter shoveling. Tokyo Rose is on the radio. She said, and then she, meaning Molly, Myrtle, is saying, she says she's leaving, but she don't go. Now that to me is also very haunting, because it's like the year in and year out of domestic drudgery, and she hates it. And she says, I'm leaving here, but she's not going anywhere. When you're in the middle of Saskatoon, or this was before Saskatoon, Saskatoon was more of a city. They called Saskatoon the Paris of the North, the city of bridges. Okay. This was North Battleford, really the middle of nowhere. Imagine really being in the middle of nowhere, all that snow, nowhere to go, not enough money to travel, no escape. You're just doing those chores every day. Now, Joni believed that there was dignity to doing domestic work, but she also figured out a way to get out of it, right? Out of the blue, just passing through, a young flight sergeant on 2 weeks' leave says, Myrtle McKee, no one else will do, and seals the tea leaf prophecy. And then here's her parents having sex. Oh, these nights are strong and soft, private passions and secret storms. That's beautiful. let's sing that about you. That's so. That's, there's something so tender about that, I think, and very loving. Nothing about him ticks her off, which I think, especially when you hear her sing it, Joni is someone who's very easily ticked off. So when she says no, nothing about him ticks her off, that's like, that's a major achievement that nothing ticks her off. And he looks so cute in his uniform. Okay, I think we can, so what Herbie does musically was with such artistry, it's so beautiful. And you hear Joni's favorite musician, Wayne Shorter, play the saxophone on this. Wayne Shorter played on 10 Joni albums. And Wayne Shorter was—he started out with Art Blakey, and then he started out with Miles Davis, and he was like the greatest composer of the '60s of a certain kind of jazz composition. And he's such an intuitive player that like he brings the right amount of space, he brings the right personality, he understands Joni's personality, and you hear it in everything that he does. And at one point, there's a line. Now there's three of them laughing around the radio, and you hear Wayne Shorter's making the sound of like people laughing on a soprano saxophone. It's beautiful. And this version is more beautiful than the original version, I think. And so here it is. And then you get to hear the sound of Joni's voice on her final recording. And she makes the most of how heavy her voice has become. She is a lifelong smoker. Smoked 4 packs a day. I know. Including around me. I am not a smoker, but I had a lot of secondhand smoke with Joni. And I'd have like my clothes dry cleaned every time I spent time with her because I just, anyway, worth it. Okay, so this is very beautiful. Yeah, no, Wayne Shorter comes in on soprano saxophone. Oh, it's right there.
The able-bodied have shipped away. Burl McKee gets her tea leaves red. You'll be married in a month, they say. These leaves are crazy. Just look at this town, there's no men left. Just frail old boys and babies talking to teacher in the treble clef. She plants her garden in the spring. She does the winter shoveling. Tokyo Rose is talking on the radio. She says, I'm leaving here, but she don't go. Out of the blue, just passing through, a young flight sergeant on 2 weeks leave says, Merle McKee, no one else will do. Then he seals the tea leaf prophecy. Ah, those nights were strong and soft, private passions and secret stones. Nothing about him ticked around, and he looked so cute in his uniform. She plants her garden in the spring. He does the winter shoveling. But summer's just a sneeze in a long, long, bad winter cold. Soon she says, I'm leaving here, but she don't go.
You know, saxophone. on this that he'd never really thought about lyrics before. But he put the understanding of the lyrics into that playing.
Sleep, little darling. This is your happy home. Your shima cannot be pardoned. Don't have kids when you get grown. This world is shattered. The wise are mourning. The fools are joking. Oh, what does it matter? The wash needs ironing. And the fire needs stoking.
I do want to keep those lyrics on the screen, though. Davey, if I could just turn back to the previous. Yeah, there. Perfect. Great. So sleep, little darling. Sleep, little darling. This is your happy home. Sleep, little darling, this is your happy home. Hiroshima cannot be pardoned. Don't have kids when you get grown. Now, Joni said that this is what her mother used to say to her all the time when she was a kid. And that meant that she was a pain in the ass. Don't have kids when you get grown. Now, Joni managed to both take that advice and not take that advice. Because she did have a kid, but she didn't raise her. There's something about Joni that is so extraordinary, and that is the bracing honesty of everything she does. And she doesn't care if you like her. I think that's very rare in pop music. Most pop performers, they want you to think they're sexy, they want you to like them, they want you to think they're cute. You know, she doesn't want any of those things. She's actually telling life exactly how she sees it. And so I just don't have kids when you get grown. That's very dark. And you keep going. Because this world is shattered. This world is shattered. That's Joni. Her mother never said this world is shattered. Joni's saying that. This world is shattered. The wise are mourning. The fools are joking. Oh, what does it matter? The wash needs ironing and the fire needs stoking. So it's like you've got domestic duties that distract you from the fact that the world is shattered. Now, there was never a time when it seemed more unassailable that the world was shattered than World War II, quite obviously. However, one still feels this way. And I was teaching my Joni Mitchell class, and It happened to be when the Brett Kavanaugh hearings were going on in the Senate, and my students insisted on watching some of it live. So we watched maybe 5 minutes. I won't repeat what was said, except that it was just incredibly horrifying. And I just had to shut it off, and I said, this is why we need music, because this world is shattered. Talking about this. So what made Joni Mitchell Joni Mitchell? What set her apart from her peer group, her entire peer group? We talked about this with Bob Dylan, what made Bob Dylan special. Joni Mitchell was special for very specific reasons. Joni Mitchell did not have this lifelong dream to be a musician. She was not playing air guitar in front of the mirror or anything like that. She was an artist. She was a visual artist. She was a painter, and she wanted to be a great painter. She was not a strong student academically. She didn't get a scholarship to art school or anything like that. She went to the Calgary School of Art and Design, and it happened that she visited the place only once, and I was with her. And we walked through the halls, and I said, Joni, did they have a humanities requirement here? She said, what's that? I said, literature, philosophy, history, religion. She said, really? You call that humanity? That's pretty good. That's why we love her. She was, and they wouldn't let her smoke, so she was not in a good mood when she was there. Anyway, you know, here's how she started playing guitar, though. She was a bit of a tomboy. Like, her friends were always guys, and that was the case for the rest of her life. Her best friends are guys. And it's interesting, because after she had an aneurysm and she needed a lot of support, all of these women came out of the woodwork and were sleeping on the floor of the hospital and stuff. These women I'd never heard of. They were like in the second or third tier of her friends, because women are more likely to do that. I think it turned out, and that these guys that she had fun with, they were sort of more fair-weathered types in the end. That's certainly how she felt about a lot of the men she went out with, that like if anything went wrong with her, they said they act like you're a toy and you just got broken, and then they want to get a new toy. What am I going to do? My toy is broken, right? So Joni had this group of guys that she was on a bowling team with them, okay? And her favorite thing to do was to dance at the Y. And she loved dancing at the Y. So now she loved to dance anyway, but I feel like she especially loved to dance because she was injured from her polio. She was weakened from polio. She actually wanted to be an athlete before she had polio. She wanted to be like a champion swimmer, champion gymnast, something. She had polio, and when she gets back from having polio, and by the way, a word about having polio, by the way. She's 10 years old. She just turned 10, November 7th, 1953. Happens to be the last year that Canada is without the Salk vaccine. It took the Salk vaccine a little longer to get to Canada than to the States. And so she's on her. So she tells this story. She looks in the mirror and she looks a little bit different. She saw some puffiness in her face, and she said, "You're a woman today. You look like a woman today." And on her way to school, she trips and she can't get up. And she's taken to a polio colony in Saskatoon, which was about 2 hours away from North Battleford. And her father never visited her. Her mother visited once. And when she visited, she had a mask on and she brought her a Christmas tree. And then turned around and left. And I think that abandonment that she experienced then, it affected all of her relationship decisions for the rest of her life. Because she didn't trust. Even when she wanted to trust, she didn't really trust. So she's at the polio ward. The doctors put her in a room with a boy who died. She thought that they thought that she was going to die too. That's why they were in this room together. So she's there while this boy is dying, and she's trying to summon up the spirit to survive. And so she starts singing Christmas songs, and she's singing them to the tree. Now, she'd already broken with the church, so she didn't really have anybody to pray to. She'd broken with the church because they wouldn't answer her questions. Okay, she's 8 years old, she's going to church, and then she says, Adam and Eve were the first people, right? Right. And then they had Cain and Abel, right? Right. Okay, and then Cain killed Abel, right? Right. Okay, well, then who did Cain marry? Eve? She was 8 years old, she didn't know what incest was. But the people, they were so offended. And after that, she thought, I'm on to something here. This is, and then what she said was, I like stories, but I feel like these stories have pages torn out of them, which was very insightful, of course. And so she was done with the church, but now she's, you know, she doesn't have her legs and she needs somebody to pray to. So she prays to the tree. And she says to the tree, look, give me my legs back. give me my legs back and I'll make it up to you. I don't know how yet, but I'll figure out some way. I will make it up to you. So the boy dies. She gets her legs back, you know, and eventually she gets to come home. She wanted to come home for Christmas, which didn't happen, but she eventually does come home. And then she's in the choir, and no one wants to sing the descant part because it's the most difficult part. And she says, I'll sing the descant part. I'm doing it for the tree. And that was the beginning of this bargain that she had for the rest of her life. Okay. So she's in high school. She meets my favorite, I've met so many people through this book. I think my favorite Joni source was this guy named Tony Simon. Tony Simon was really a riot. Tony Simon would tell me these stories. He would say, this is Tony from Saskatoon. Tony would say, you know, I was in the kitchen with Joni's mom. And she said, hey, Tony. I said, yeah. She said, Tony, you know, Joni wrote a song, eh? I said, no. She said, yeah. I said, really? And at that time, this might be a little politically incorrect, but that might be like saying your best friend's queer. Because no one knew anybody who was queer. And no one who knew anybody who'd written a song, eh? Anyway, Tony Simon was on the bowling team with a bunch of other guys. And they would go to campfires, and they would sing dirty limericks. Like, there once was a boy from Nantucket type thing. Okay? This is how Joni started as a guitar player. Because nobody played the guitar, and they needed someone to play the guitar so they could sing There Once Was a Boy from Nantucket. So Joni was like, I'll do it. And so she gets this baritone ukulele, and she starts fooling around with it. And that's the beginning of her fooling around with guitar. It was so that she could do that. And then she would take it everywhere. She would take it to the movies. She would take it everywhere. People got very annoyed with her. Joni came from a generation that Margaret Atwood called the Canadian lunatic generation. And what that meant was that at that time, Canada was just a blank space in global culture. And if you were Margaret Atwood and you were gonna and you said, I'm Margaret Atwood, I'm gonna become a major novelist, or I'm Joni Mitchell and I'm gonna become a major singer-songwriter, they would say, you're a lunatic. Because that's just how it was then. And so Joni goes to art school in Calgary. It was a terrible time for Joni to be in art school because Joni loves Van Gogh, she loves Picasso, she loves Rembrandt, and this was a time when everybody was following Barnett Newman. And so we have an artist, there's an artist here, Barnett Newman was a minimalist. He would have like one color, white on white. It was like, that's art, you know. And so she thought that this was disgusting, and she didn't like the hipsters that were following these things. And so to make a buck, this was during the folk revival, the folk revival that Dylan was a part of, but just a couple of years later. And so Joni at that point played baritone, playing on baritone uke was getting to the point where her repertoire was beyond There Once Was a Boy from Nantucket, and was now she was now listening to all the Joan Baez and Judy Collins records, and she was a very talented mimic, and so she could mimic Joan Baez and Judy Collins. These were women that she came to dislike personally later, but she started off imitating them. And with Judy Collins, it was pretty ungrateful because she really gave her the start of her career. But anyway, those were the women to imitate at that time. And so she was good at this, and she was, you know, very easy on the eye. And so she got a gig at a club called The Depression in Calgary and got $25 a week, which was great. And because there were only two things that she needed money for: records and smokes. She had enough money for records and smokes, that's all she needed, and she was fine. And so she finished her first year at art school, and then in the beginning of her second year in art school, she was sharing an apartment with somebody that I interviewed, and there was this guy that used to come over a lot, His name was Brad McMath, very nice looking chap. They called him Moochie because he always came over when they were preparing supper. So one day, Joni was at that time, she was the last virgin in art school. Okay, this is 1964. She's the last virgin in art school. And suddenly, there was Moochie, the two of them, on the couch alone. And suddenly, she is no longer the last virgin in art school. And she got pregnant. I believe, and I talked to a lot of people about this, because she always liked to say that she lost her virginity and got pregnant at the same time. But Larry Klein, her second husband, and many other people told me that that was really true. She lost her virginity and got pregnant at the same time. It was all the things that her parents were warning her about, and it actually happened. And so she drops out of art school, and she and Moochie go as far away as she can go from Calgary, where nobody knows her. There's no social media. You know, she could just hide. It's 1964. And so they went to a place that she'd never really spent any time in, and that was Toronto. Toronto is very far. It's like a 14-hour train ride from Calgary. You know, Canada's so big geographically. You've got the West with Vancouver, and then you've got the prairies, and that's where you have Calgary, and that's where you have Saskatoon and all that. And then the East is Montreal and Toronto. So Joni goes to Toronto. She knows there's a folk scene there, so she knows that she can get work in folk clubs there. She had no money for the to join the union, so she had to play the best of the scab clubs. And she barely had enough money for anything, and her neighbors saw that she was pregnant. They took pity on her, and would give her fruit and stuff like that. And Moochie bailed pretty quickly once she arrived there. And he left her a note, and it had a drawing of a pregnant woman, and on the note it just said, it was a quotation from an old Japanese Buddhist poem, and the quotation was, "The moon at the window, the thief left it behind." And much, much later, she actually had a song called "Moon at the Window" with that chorus. But it was about getting that note. And so now she's on her own, and she's struggling, and she's penniless, and she's only playing the scab clubs. And after a while, she starts to show to the point when she can't even play the scab clubs anymore because she's just too pregnant. And so she has a daughter on February 19th, 1965. And that is what the song is about. This is a song that she wrote in 1966, but she didn't put it on her first three albums. She waited until it was her fourth album, Blue, that she finally put it on an album. The song is called Little Green. Davey, I think it was on the previous screen because I don't see it here. Yes, thank you. Hand for Davey, by the way. Davey's keeping all of this. Thank you. Yeah, can we full screen it? There it is, I see. Okay, now, before we play this, this is a song. I devoured Joni Mitchell's music starting in 1988. Once I was lying in bed with that girl, that was all I needed. Became completely obsessed. And so, of course, I own Blue. This is when I was special ordering vinyl, by the way, because they were phasing vinyl out for CDs. So I had the vinyl of it still, which had lyrics to all of these songs, including the one that you're about to hear, Little Green. And I had no idea what it was about. And nobody had any idea what it was about. The guy that reviewed it in Rolling Stone, his name is Timothy Krause, and he said, This music has such poetic language. It passeth all understanding. But then once the story came out that Joni was reunited with her daughter when her daughter was 32 years old, look at this. Look at this. One, two, three. This on the fourth line down, the fourth stanza. And I got the story, and then this thing was quoted. Whoops. I got to the story, and this thing was quoted, and I said, I am an idiot. Because look at this. Child with a child pretending, weary of lies you are sending home. So you sign all the papers in the family name. You're sad and you're sorry, but you're not ashamed. Little green, have a happy ending. It's right there. Joni used to say, do you get the picture? Because she's a painter, so everything's visual. Do you get the picture? Like, do you get the picture moment? And I thought, how? None of us knew what this was about. And it's so obvious what this is about. Now, this particular performance that you're about to see is 4 years before Blue was released. It's from 1967. And what's particularly significant about this performance is that Joni was at the end of the period when she was just living from gig to gig. The royalties didn't come in from Judy Collins, Both Sides Now, until 1968. So she was still kind of just living from gig to gig. She would shortly meet David Crosby, and David Crosby would help her get her first record deal with Warner Reprise. But this was a month before that. So she has no idea that that's going to happen. And there's a guy in the audience named Elliot Roberts, who was really Elliot Rabinowitz. And Elliot Rabinowitz Roberts comes up to her, and he was an advertising guy. He was like a character on Mad Men, basically. And he went up to Joni and said, listen, I would kill to manage you. He knew nothing about being a manager, but he just thought he was so persuaded by what he saw. They thought, I'm going to figure out how to be a manager. And she didn't have one. So he went up to her and he said, I would kill to manage you. I would do anything. I would quit my job to manage you. And she said, well, I've got a gig tomorrow in Ann Arbor. And if you can show up at the airport and pay your own expenses, you can come along. And this was and Elliot Roberts died a few months ago. This was the beginnings of a lot of things, but nobody knew it at the time. But Joni is putting on this beautiful show, and she's singing this song that, with these obvious lyrics, but I think people are so noticing the beauty of everything that's going on that they don't really think of what it actually means. And on the record for Blue, she says, little green, have a happy ending. But at the end of this performance, you actually see her saying Kelly Green, which is what she called her daughter, Kelly. She ended up taking the name Kaloran, but at the time she called her Kelly Dale Anderson.
Choose her a name she will answer to. Call her green and the winters cannot fade her. Call her green for the children who have made her. Little green, be a gypsy dancer. He went to California hearing that everything's warmer there. So you write him a letter and her eyes are blue. He sends you a poem and she's lost to you. Little green, be a nonconformer. Just a little green, like the color when the spring is born. There'll be crocuses to bring to school tomorrow. Just a little green, like the nights when northern lights perform. There'll be icicles and birthday clothes, and sometimes there'll be sorrow. Child with a child pretending. Weary of lies you are sending home. So you sign all the papers for the family name. You're sad and you're sorry, but you're not ashamed, little green. Have a happy ending. Just a little green, like the color when the spring is born. There'll be crocuses to bring to school tomorrow. Just a little green, like the nights when northern lights perform. There'll be icicles and birthday clothes, and sometimes there'll be sorrow. Born child with a dream cancer.
And I feel like it's the Joni Mitchell effect, where she is like laying everything out there blatantly, but then she's doing it with such beauty that your mind is distracted. You're noticing the chords, you're noticing the voice, and so people were obviously like missing what she was saying, which was exactly what she intended. I think that she wanted to get something out there, but I think that she wanted to be like a kind of a phantom thread, you know. Woven in there, and so only the most intrepid would catch it. And so, speaking of intrepid, I think this is the time when I get to take some questions or comments.
We'll open up for questions. Mm-hmm. I'll pass the mic around.
If she smoked 4 packs a day, yes. How is she still alive? Does she have lung issues?
So the question is, if she smoked 4 packs a day, how is she still alive? Well, she, you know, her parents, you know, her father lived to be 100 and her mother lived to be 95. And so she's got good genes and she's a very tough and resilient person. You have to be lucky, of course. Since she had a brain aneurysm on March 31st, 2015, she's been under constant medical supervision, so nobody's letting her have a cigarette. And she's still trying to get one. She's still haggling for one. And I'm thinking, you know, maybe it would be a good move, because next time I go to Los Angeles, maybe I should visit her and maybe I could sneak something in. No, I can't. I can't.
Can you tell us a little bit more about her reunion with her daughter?
Oh, yes. And that, you know, the question was about her reunion with her daughter. Joni has another song that we didn't have time to hear called Chinese Cafe, which also is very blatantly about, my child's a stranger, I bore her but I could not raise her, nothing lasts for long. She decided to go public with this when she figured her parents might get over it, you know, when they were in their 80s. And of course they said, oh, well, we would have been there for her. But she didn't feel that way at the time. Anyway, so there was this guy who founded Joni Mitchell's website, which is funny because Joni hates the web. But he founded JoniMitchell.com. His name was Wally Breeze. And he put out the search of someone who's going to match this baptismal certificate from February 19th, 65. And you can imagine many women came out of the woodworks wanting to be Joni Mitchell's daughter. But there was this one, Kaloran, and they had the time of day, which was correct, and it said mother's occupation, folk singer. And that's how they made the match. And Kaloran had found out that she was adopted earlier and had been wanting to find her birth mother for quite some time, because she did not quite fit into this family that adopted her. You know, they were upper middle class, and they were very proper people, and they were also not very attractive people. And she was very beautiful and very much a wild child and didn't fit in with the rest of this family. And so they did meet. And the story is a story of it's a very Joni Mitchell romance, because it started out very giddy and Joni was saying all kinds of things like, oh, now the circle is closed in my life. I don't need to write songs anymore. I was just writing songs because I was waiting for my daughter to come back. And all of my songs were about my daughter and you know, wondering about the world that she was going to inherit. And you know, so like Big Yellow Taxi was really for her daughter. Or, you know, these songs where she's like saying basically the world is shattered, is she's really thinking about her daughter. but I think that it was a lot easier for her to deal with her daughter in the abstract when she was a little green, because she's her mother's daughter, but she's Joni without the talent. She's very beautiful and a major pain in the ass. The one profession that she had was that she was a runway model. You know, she's a very beautiful woman. She had beautiful parents. A runway model, yeah. But I just got the sense that she was a mess. But however, I liked her grandson very much. I took her and her grandson out, and but the coolest thing, I put this in the book, was she had a tattoo, and it was in green gothic font, and it said "Little Green" in quotation marks, and then she said, "Don't tell my mom, she wouldn't approve." But of course I did, and then I told her, and Joni said she doesn't know me. So they've been on and off ever since.
Can you tell us about the connection with Charles Mingus?
Oh yeah. Charles Mingus was diagnosed with ALS, which is Lou Gehrig's disease, in November of 77. And so his wife, Sue, is a friend of mine, was scrambling for a project, hopefully something that would make a little bit of money while he was dying, because they knew that he would lose the ability not only to play, but to even speak. And so he was like... He was making his final compositions by just like singing very weakly into a tape recorder. And
he's down in Mexico, right?
Well, he went to Mexico to go to this phony healer named Pachita. But his wife Sue had moved them into this artist housing at 43rd and 10th, called Manhattan Plaza, where other jazz musicians lived. Dexter Gordon lived there. Joni was, they wanted Joni to think that she was summoned by the great man himself, even though we'd never heard of her. They figured that would be more of a lure. They knew that she'd been playing with Jaco Pastorius and Wayne Shorter, and they knew that she was, you know, experimenting with jazz. And so this could be like the next step for her. And it worked. And she went to see him, and she adored him immediately. On Joni's previous album, Don Juan's Reckless Daughter, she made the most ambitious song she would ever make. It was called Paprika Plains. It took up an entire side on the record. It was 16 minutes. And it had an orchestral section in it. And people who noticed that there was a point where the strings went out of tune. I talked to the conductor about this, about why that was, which was interesting. But so when Joni first walks in and he's in a wheelchair and he's like facing the window, and he said, "Those strings on Paprika Plains are out of tune." And she said, "Oh, you noticed that?" You know? And it was just for a moment of out of tuneness. But anyway, so he would tell her stories, and then she would use the stories as the basis for songs, for lyrics, you know. She wrote the lyrics that are still used for "Goodbye Pork Pie Hat," because they're the best ones. They're better than John Hendrix's. And she was walking around New York City, and it was very difficult for him to come up with that final verse, but she did, and it was a great triumph. But it was also a career suicide, you know. And the people at the label, which was Asylum Records at the time, they said, "Joni, you're never going to get your audience back." And they were right. She never really did. But she always said it was worth it. It was worth it for the musical education. He was not alive to hear the finished record.
He
would not have approved of it either, but it was her record. I mean, she had him rehearse with these groups that he handpicked. They were all people that had played with him. Danny Richmond and all these people, Don Pollan. She didn't feel right until she was around her own people, which was Herbie and Jaco and, you know, Peter Erskine from Weather Report. That record is so unique. I mean, because there's not a great lyric writing tradition in jazz like there should be.
She had already recorded twice with Pastorius before she went to...
That's right. That's right. This was the third one with Jaco. That's right. But I mean, I think there's some of the greatest lyrics for jazz that have ever been written.
I think she abandoned pop music and,
right.
and no qualms about it.
No. No. I mean, so it was career suicide, but I think it was for a worthy goal. And by the way, it sold better than any Charles Mingus record would have sold. It did go silver, so it at least sold 250,000, which would be a lot for a jazz album.
Okay, we have one over here.
Yes.
Can you tell us something about the Judy Collins, Joni Mitchell relationship?
Sure. I had to talk to Judy twice to get this. She told me this while she was having.
Can you just repeat the question?
Oh yeah, the question was about the relationship with Judy Collins. Okay. Joni lived in New York City. She lived between early 67 and it was basically through 67. She lived on 16th Street between 5th and 6th. She got mugged 3 times when she lived there. Al Cooper had come over. Al Cooper of Blood, Sweat, and Tears, and Al Cooper who played with Dylan in 65. Joni was playing him her recent songs. And so one of them was Both Sides Now, which she had written like a month earlier. This was April of 67. So as soon as, when Al Cooper heard Both Sides Now, he thought, oh my God, Judy Collins should hear this. So he called Judy Collins in the middle of the night. It was like 3 a.m. And he didn't say, oh, sorry to wake you or anything like that. He just said, you've got to hear this. And he put the phone on to Joni, and Joni didn't say, you know, hi Judy, how are you? Or sorry for waking you. Nothing. She just sang the song. And then she didn't say goodbye. And then Al Cooper got back on the phone and he said, what do you think? And Judy said, I'm recording it tomorrow. She was recording her Wildflowers album then. And so she did. She went to the studio the next day and you know, she had some. Josh Rifkin came over, got the chords. The chords are pretty simple, and then came up with that harpsichord arrangement, which is sort of important for the record selling. I mean, you know, she was very aware of like mixes that were just right, like how you made a hit, you know. And so even though she recorded it in one day, it took them 8 months to mix it and do all these other things to it to make it sound like a hit record. And it was. It hit number 7 on the pop charts. And then it won a Grammy for best folk record. And that was the beginning of Joni's career. That was the end of Joni living from gig to gig. That was the beginning of her actually putting some money away. And then she got signed herself, you know, in early 68 to Warner Reprise. And then her career started. And so there's a picture of Joni and Judy Collins hanging out in the treehouse in Joni's backyard in Laurel Canyon. So they were friends then, but after a while, every time Joni came out with an album, Judy would like write her a love letter. She would send her gifts. She would say, "I love you, Joni. This album is so wonderful." And Joni just stopped responding after a long time. She just stopped responding. And eventually, when Judy would call, and Joni would never take the call. Larry Klein, when she was married to Larry Klein would take the call, and so Klein got to know her. And so finally, Joni was playing her first acoustic show in 21 years. It was at UCLA in 1993, and Judy comes backstage, and Joni says. She looks to the left, she looks to the right, she says, Larry Klein, and she gets on Larry Klein's lap, Joni's husband's lap. And Joni said, I wonder who she wants something from now. And no, Judy's like a theater person. She's like a Broadway person and like a cabaret person. And that's a very different sensibility than Joni's sensibility. Like, I personally adored her. I thought she was incredibly charming. But I think that the thing that made me find her charming was the thing that Joni probably was disgusted by.
We'll take one more.
Okay. Yes.
Very quick question and very short. Who, after Barnett Newman, who is she currently interested in as an artist?
Well, she posed for a photograph recently with David Hockney. So I assume that she likes David Hockney. It's a totally different world. Yeah, I think David Hockney is, I mean, the thing about it, like her paintings, which are on the covers of some of her albums, is that she was a very vivacious painter, and maybe she wouldn't have made it as a painter, but she certainly had a lot of talent and a lot of life to her work. But I could see how like the her figurative painting would be something that would be somehow akin to David Hockney. More so than Barnett Newman, is exactly right.
Thank you very much. Please give a round of applause and join us for reception afterwards.
Thank you.